where we started.
Coming back to where we started.
Coming back to where we started.
Coming back to where
I first felt your love. You're all that matters, Jesus. You're all that matters.
You're all that matters.
Coming back to what really matters.
Coming back to what really matters.
Just your heart.
Just give me your heart.
Just wanna bless your heart,
Jesus.
I'm caught up in your presence. I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never wanna leave.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you.
In the name of Jesus.
Lord, we bless you and we adore you. We exalt your wonderful name.
Yes.
God, we just want to be in your presence.
Yes, Jesus.
We just want to sit at your feet.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you for the opportunity and the privilege and the honor to be in your presence.
Yes.
We are so grateful for it. We just want to say thank you, Lord.
Yes.
God.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you so much thank for such Jesus. A wonderful, awesome, yes. holy, magnificent, God. Perfect bless God that take the time out and want to come and sit in our midst.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you, God.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, we ask you to move by your spirit in this service, and not just this service, every service that's erected in your yes. name, every yes. service that's going forth pushing your agenda, yes. every service going forth pushing your will, yes. every service going forth pushing you, Lord. We yes. say that you invade those services yes. by Jesus. Your spirit.
Yes.
We decree and declare that breakthroughs, healings, yes. miracles will take place by the floods in the name of
in
Jesus.
The name of
Make
Jesus.
Your name great. We yes. decree your name made great in yes. this earth in yes, Jesus'
Lord.
Name.
In Jesus' name.
Let thy name be made great.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, we decree thy name be yes. made great.
Great.
Hallelujah. Your
Hallelujah.
Name be exalted in yes. all the earth.
Yes.
Your name be lifted and lifted off every lip. And your name be made great in this earth.
Yes, Lord.
We decree your name great. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Holy Spirit, we thank you for showing up. Yes. You are already here.
Yes.
Move as you see fit, Spirit of the living God.
Yes,
in Jesus' name. Jesus and all those name. Agree, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Come on, let's give God some praise.
Give him
Hallelujah.
A praise shout in this place. Because he's worthy.
Hallelujah.
He deserves it, God. We serve a great big God. Yes, we do. Come on, stand to your feet and worship with us this morning. Let's get in the presence of our King. Hallelujah. Abundantly above all, according to the power that works through you and me, you and give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you. He's able. Come on, clap it out.
Do.
just what he said he would do. He's on a fulfilled promise to you.
Yes, he will.
Don't give up on God, cause he won't give up on
he's
you.
He's what? He's able.
Hallelujah.
Let it out. Come on.
Glory, hallelujah.
He's able. Yes, he is. He's an able God.
Yes, hallelujah.
Yes, hallelujah. Oh. Oh. Give up on us, because he's a great God. Hallelujah. I feel him in this place. Yes, Lord. We came to worship you this morning, Lord, in spirit and truth, because we love you. That's why we do what we do. We love you, and we are grateful, very, very grateful for what God is doing for us. We woke up this morning, and we bless him just for that, because it's nothing small about it. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you, I worship you. Y'all know it, come on. You are here, mending every heart. Mending every heart. I worship you, I worship you. Turning lives around. You are here. You're turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. Mending every heart. You are here. Mending every heart. worship you. Come on, y'all, lift your voice and tell them. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. That's it, that's it. Hey, waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. We worship you. We worship you. You are here, mending every heart, and we worship you, we worship you. Come on, it's my favorite part, because you are a way maker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Hey. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. Mending every heart, I worship you, and we worship you. Come on, come on, raise it. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Hey, a waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Hallelujah, that's who you are. Bless the name of Jesus, because if he's your way maker, let me hear you say hallelujah. Yes, we are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We come to worship you this morning. And in truth. Hallelujah. Bless the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. You can turn it up a little bit, Jay. Yes, at the mention of your name. At the mention of your name, every knee must bow, every tongue confess that you are Lord. Is he Lord, y'all?
At the mention of your name, every knee must bow, every tongue confess that you are Lord.
Yes, he is. Jesus, you are Lord.
At the mention of your name, every knee must bow, every tongue confess that you are Lord.
It's all right to raise your hands, y'all.
Jesus, you are Lord. Oh, oh. Jesus, you are Lord. Oh, oh. Jesus, you are Lord. Lord, oh, oh, oh,
At the mention of your name, the scales fall from their eyes, blinded eyes can see that you are Lord. How's that sound? Let me hear y'all shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. At the mention of your name, the scales fall from their eyes, and blinded eyes can see that you are Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Cause Jesus, you are Lord. Oh, oh. Jesus, you are Lord. Oh, for being Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus is Lord. It's a simple song, but the words are so strong, because when you say Jesus is Lord, you are saying he's above everything. Yes, yes. When somebody is Lord in your life, they are above everything, and that's what he is to us. He's everything in our lives. He's vital for us. Yes. People take vitamins every day, y'all, because they feel like it makes them stronger physically, but Jesus is vital. He is. Like, I couldn't do life without him. Yeah, I don't understand how people have a life that's exempt from having Jesus in their life, because he's everything. He's our force. He's our shield. He's our power. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Bless the name of God. Lord, we just thank you for this time of worship, this time of reflection, this time to be in your presence, to just sit and love on you, and to get your wisdom, your infinite wisdom, and what it is that you are saying for our lives, Lord. Let's just take a moment and just close our eyes and meditate on God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Let's just let him know how grateful we are to be in his presence right now.
Yes.
If you have a prayer for someone, just say their name in your head. If you got a prayer for yourself, say your name. If you got need healing in your body, just touch your body and say, body, be healed in the name of Jesus. Because he's here, and whenever he's present, everything that we need is present in his presence. So just take your blessing, because I feel him. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we worship you. We bless your name. Yes, Lord, bless your name. We bless your name because we love your name. Your name is precious to us. Your name is sweet to us. We love the name of Jesus. 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 You're welcome here. You're so welcome here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We feel your presence, Lord. Hallelujah. Bless your name. We live to bless your name. We live to raise your name. We live to bless your name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the King. Y'all feel his presence? Thank you, Jesus. It's so sweet. God is so sweet. He's so sweet, and he loves us so much. We couldn't even imagine the love that God has for us. I feel it. I feel his love. I feel his presence. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you. We worship you. Thank you, Lord. We thank you for what you're about to do in this meeting, Lord. Our minds and our hearts are prepared for the message that you have prepared for us. We wanted to bless everyone that hears it, Father God, and we thank you that it will grow them up in you. We thank you that the purpose for which you have given it to us, that it will just meet that purpose and that need in everyone's life that is watching today. We bless them.
Yes, God.
With your abundance and your favor and your covering. In the mighty name of Jesus.
In Jesus' name.
And if you agree with that, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We love you, Jesus. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We bless you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. We magnify you, Jesus. We glorify you, Jesus. We are in the presence of the King. And the Bible says that in his presence there's fullness of joy. Fullness of joy. So if there's anything in your life that does not represent joy, it can't be here, because he's here. And he's not going to leave. So that thing that is not, that's holding you back from experiencing joy, has to go. Say with me, say, the joy of the Lord is my strength. I am strengthened because the King is here. We are entertaining the King. And when you entertain a king, your heart needs to be in a certain position. When you are entertaining a king, you don't allow other things to mess with your mind. You put your focus on the King. And when you put your focus on the King, what happens is you get healed. There's redemption when you set your eyes on the King. If you fix your eyes on him, the Bible says that he'll keep you in not peace, but perfect peace. And see, that's the different kind of peace, right? See, we know peace, but he's saying, I'm not going to give you that level of peace, because that's not of me. I'm going to give you perfect peace. And the Bible says he'll give you perfect peace, but look, only if what happens? If your mind is stayed on who? On him. So don't put your mind on nothing else right now. Don't think about what's happening, what's not happening. If you keep your mind on the King, you'll be in perfect peace. Say, I choose to keep my mind on the King. Therefore, I receive by faith perfect peace. All right, all right, all right. Let's take communion. Let's keep this perfect peace going. Father, everybody has the communion? You don't have one? Give me two right here, please. Thank you so much, family. Here you are. Here you are. All right. Father, we're going to now take full advantage of perfect peace. We thank you for perfect peace. And Jesus gave us perfect peace on the cross. And every Sunday, we partake of perfect peace whenever we partake of the perfection of the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. So family, here we go. I want you to place your hands on yourself. I want you to speak to yourself, and I say this. Say, I speak to every joint, every ligament, every organ, every muscle, every tendon, every bone, every cell in my body, and I command that my body be perfect, because right now we are transferring bodies. Jesus, your body is now my body. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. That was a great transaction. We trade bodies. We have a perfected body. We thank you for the blood, oh God. It is the blood that makes all things right. It's the blood that pays the price. They're still paying the price today. It paid the price, and it's still paying the price. Isn't that something? So we have this blood that pays the price. It's an ongoing payment. Not a one-time thing. It's ongoing. That's shouting material. We thank you, Jesus, for this blood that you shed. The blood that sets us free, the blood that brings us into right standings with you, with the Father in heaven. We thank you for the blood that has angels here. And Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you that you're going to minister to us based on this blood here. We thank you, Father, that we are aging backwards. Like Moses, we are strong with no dim in our eyes. We are aging in reverse. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right. I want to acknowledge our lovely lady Kay. We are celebrating her birthday. Woo! Her birthday was on Friday, But as a church family, we get to celebrate it together today, which is awesome. Thank every single one of you guys for celebrating this amazing vessel. I'll be honest, I thank God for Jesus and for Katrina. Because Katrina makes it all doable and all possible. She is a strong force in my life, and I tell you, I just thank God for her. I know for sure when God stitched her in Eunice's womb, he had Enrique in mind. So thank God for being mindful. We also want to say happy birthday to Nene. Today is her birthday. So Nene, if you are watching, happy birthday. God bless you. Thank you so much. Can we sing happy birthday? Ready? One, two, three. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear birthday. And Nene too. Happy birthday to you. There's nothing like, you know, I tell you, I'm going to tell you something. Love is so amazing. It's the strongest thing in all the earth. When you give somebody love and people feel celebrated, there's nothing like that. You know, man, listen, every chance we get, let's celebrate each other. Let's celebrate everything, every milestone, everything, anniversaries, birthdays. I celebrate you today because you're here. I mean, come on now. God woke us up this morning. That is celebration right there because somebody this morning did not wake up. Let's pause for 1 second. Somebody did not wake up this morning. Let's say thank you, Jesus. Yeah. Okay, so I'm doing something new today, and today our topic is God's greatest desire. That's what I'm going to speak about today. Is God's greatest desire. What I'm asking for everyone to do is pull out your phones if you don't mind, and even on social media, I'm asking for you guys to continue our partnership going, and part of the partnership is to share what we're doing. We are a fairly new ministry, and we want to get the word out, so you guys partner with us whenever you press that share button, because now we are being exposed to other people, and truthfully speaking, we get a pretty decent word every time we come together. So why not share this message? So I'm asking for those here, and I'm asking for those out there on social media to do something really simple. Take that finger of yours and just press share to help us share this message with your family and friends. Amen? Thank you in advance for being a person who would help us to move the message forward. The theme for this year is being about my Father's business. And I just want to make this short declaration, and I'm asking for you guys to join me in saying this. Say, in 2021, my focus is to be about my Father's business. I refuse to allow anyone or anything to take me off of my path. In Jesus' name, amen. Did you hear what you just said? You said you refuse to allow anyone or anything to take you off your path. So you said you refuse it. That means that you're the one in control. The thing is not in control. The person is not in control. If you get off of your path, that simply means one thing. Come on, class. It means that you lost control. They didn't make you do anything because you said that you're going to stay on your path. And you said you refuse. You got it? So stay focused and stay on your path. Holy Spirit, I thank you for your presence. We come to you now yielding for your counsel. We are ready to receive from you. We are ready for a word straight from God himself. Let us glorify Jesus today. We don't have an agenda if it's not yours. We don't have a will if it's not yours. What I'm asking for you to do is do whatever it is that you want to do. I am just a vessel, and you are the teacher. And I'm asking for you to give me revelation beyond what I can comprehend. Take us deeper, further, and higher in the Lord Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, we are here looking forward even for miracles, signs, and wonders. Heal your people in every sense of the word. Now, we welcome faith, hope, and love. And we stand boldly on the mountain of Galatians 2 and 20. Have your way. In Jesus' name, amen. I want y'all to say this with me. Say, Father, as you did for Abraham and Isaac, afford me your assistance in all things I desire. In Jesus' name. Isn't that powerful? Afford me your assistance in all things that I desire. All right, here is our lesson for today. The topic is God's greatest desire. What does God desire from us the most? What does God desire from us the most? Time? Your faith? Love? All right. Well, let me ask you this question. What is the most important aspect of our relationship with God? What is the most important aspect of our relationship with God? What is it? Yeah, believing. Okay. Your soul. Okay. Let me say this to you, right? The love that you and I have for God will not sustain our relationship with God. I want to let that settle in, okay? A lot of times we focus on how much we love God. I love God. But I got news for you, that the love that you have for God and the love that I have for God will not sustain the relationship that you have with him. Because love, you know, I learned this thing, I'm telling you, and I'm learning it more and more, that love is not the most important thing in a relationship. It really isn't. Love is not enough to be in a relationship. So what I'm saying to you is that the love that you have for your mate, the love that you have for God, would not sustain that relationship. Because what happens when that love gets so tested that you're questioning what love is? See, there will be a time in the relationship that you have with God that you would actually question if God does love you. You will experience something in your life. Something will happen that make you say, God, do you love me? Are you even here? So love is not enough to sustain a relationship because you'll question the love. So God is not really focusing on how much you love him. Can I tell you what's the most important thing in a relationship? The most important aspect in any relationship, the one with your mate and the one with God, is trust. It's trust. See, but what happens is when your love for your mate or your love with God gets so tested to the point where you're questioning what love is, or you're even ready to give up on love, the only thing that can sustain you is the trust. Lord, have mercy. I tell you what, the reason why love is not the most important thing in the relationship is because I can love you, but it doesn't mean I trust you. Now, I can love you, but me trusting you is not part of the equation, because I love everybody. I'm supposed to love all people. I love the person I don't know, but I don't trust that person to come to my house. I don't know you. So for me to bring you to my house and let you in, I got to trust you. You see what I'm saying? So God says, yeah, love me. But see, at some point, the love that you have for God will be tested. And if you don't trust God, then that love goes on vacation. You will walk away from God. Why? Because I love you, but man, because this happened, and you didn't stop this, and I didn't deserve that. I just don't trust you no more. You follow what I'm saying? So now the relationship is over. Why? Because your relationship is contingent upon in earth and heaven. Your relationship in the earth and heaven is contingent upon not how much you love a person, but how much I trust you. Because you can love a person and be guarded. That relationship won't go nowhere. Because you can only go as far as the level of trust that I have for you. You got what I'm saying? Right. So what I'm saying is, you can't even go into a business relationship with someone who you just love. I love you. Let's do business. Wait a minute. I got to check this bank account because I don't know what's going on. See, there's a level of openness and a level of vulnerability when you really trust somebody. Yeah. So what is God's greatest desire? For you to love him or for you to trust him? To trust him. Because that relationship with God, your relationship with God would only go as far as not your love for him. Your relationship with God would only go as far as you trust him. Now, do you trust God when things don't happen as you desire? Do you love God when things don't work out as you feel it should? See, that's the difference. So that's what we have to focus on. Because right now, if we could be honest, there's a lot happening in this earth right now. And if we could be honest, a lot of people are questioning, does God really love them? Does God really exist? Why is that? Man, I really don't trust God because the way things are going and this happened and this happened and why did God let this happen? That ain't a love thing. That's a trust thing. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 to 6. And look what it says. I'm reading from the Amplified Classic Version. And look what it says. It says, lean on, trust in, and be confident. Look at that. Lean on, trust in, and be confident in the Lord with how much of your heart? See, so if you give God partial heart, then it ain't going to work. So trust God with all your heart, right? And mind, all your heart and mind, and do not rely on your own insight or understanding. In all your ways, recognize and acknowledge him, and he will do what? Direct and make straight your path. So watch this. He wants you to lean on, trust in, be confident in the Lord with all your heart and mind, and don't rely on what you see or think or feel. And in everything you do, look to him, even though what you think or feel doesn't feel the best. And he's going to do what? That's kind of tough. That's kind of tough. Let's be honest, right? So you're hoping for things to function a certain way. You're praying for things to be a certain way. And what you're praying for and hoping for isn't happening as you're praying for and hoping for, but just the same, I trust you in the midst of unknowing. That ain't a love thing. That's saying that even though I don't see you, and this don't feel right, and my prayers are not being answered as I think it should be, but I'm going to still trust you to direct me around this maze of confusion. Wow. That's a different level of relationship. That's when love leaves. At that point, love is gone. And what you're going to have there is full blind faith. Here is the full blind faith. No matter what happens, he won't fail me. No matter what happens, he won't point me in the wrong direction. No matter what happens, this don't feel good. Look, think about this. What do you think a relationship would be like, a marriage would be like, if we had that level of trust in our mates? I counsel people all the time, and people are in relationship who don't even trust each other. That would never work, because love can't sustain a relationship. Love would never sustain a relationship. Love would never. I'm telling you, you can forget about it. Love would not sustain any relationship. The only thing that would sustain a relationship is trust. So stop focusing on, I love him. Do you trust him? I love her. Do you trust her? Listen to what I'm saying, right? Right? Okay, listen. Okay, I got it. If you don't love a person, then you are in more, you are, okay, I got you. All right. Perfect. If you don't love a person, if you don't trust a person, fully trust a person, because there is partial trust, and partial trust is no trust at all, okay? Either you trust me with all your heart, or you don't trust me at all. I kind of sort of trust you. Okay, you don't trust me, all right? So this relationship cannot grow. Your relationship with God, or that woman, or that man, will not grow if you don't trust them with everything, okay? If there's partial trust, that relationship is limited, all right? And watch this. Where there is no trust, there is no love. Lord, help me with this. See, I can love you and not trust you. But if I don't trust you, at some point, my love for you will leave. Why? Because now I'm loving you from a fearful place. I'm loving you like CBS, one eye open and one eye closed. You know, I don't really trust this sucker right here, but you know, you follow what I'm saying? Because you see, in order for us to be in relationship, I need to have all of you. I need transparency. I need vulnerability. And that's where we fail. You see, oh boy, you cannot be a person who's guarded and be in relationship, because what happens is you are in relationship with something that is stronger than the love that you have for that person. Say wisdom. All right, here it is, right? I love you, but because I don't trust you, fear keeps me more in relationship with fear than with you. Right, so I can't trust you because I can't really love you, because the first sign of you going in the wrong direction, I'm paranoid, okay? And when paranoid comes in, then torment comes in. You got it? So when torment comes in, I'm saying that, man, I got to keep calling him because I don't know. He went to the 7-Eleven, but did he go to Susan's house? I know she said she's hanging out with her girls, but let me put a tracker on her phone. So now you are in relationship, not with love, but you are in relationship with fear. Come on, come on. And there is no fear in love. Why? I hear you, Holy Spirit. Because perfect love does what? Cast out all fear. Right. So if you are in relationship with fear, then love isn't present, because fear and love can't be in the same place, just like sweet water and bitter water can't be in the same place. Somebody say wisdom. I'm in it today. I feel this thing for Trina's birthday and Nene's birthday. Come on now. So stop saying, I love her. Do you trust her? And you can't say, I partially trust her. I trust you as far as I can see you. You don't trust me. So we're not in relationship, because you are in relationship with fear. And fear would always have you sabotage the relationship. Many of us are like that with God. Father, in Jesus' name, I surrender to you. I put this in your hands. I'm going to leave it alone. In Jesus' name, amen. Oh, let me pick it back up, though. I'm going to take it with me, because, you know, God going to take too long. And he not going to really answer, because I'm not too sure, because I did something wrong last night. He may not really answer. You know, because I sinned and I'm not really perfect and I'm still trying to work this thing out. So I got to really, you know, kill 40 cats and kill 30 dogs and then, you know, give $1,000 and then he may hear my prayer. This is where we at. Let me show you how important this is. Let's go to Jude chapter 3. I want you to see something here. The book of Jude. Jude 3. You know, thank you for correction. Jude 3. Look what it says. Beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for your faith, which was once for all delivered to the saints. Now look what he's saying. He's saying, I'm exhorting you, I'm imploring you, I'm begging you to contend, not just contend, but contend earnestly for the faith. Why would he say contend earnestly for the faith? He didn't say contend for love. Because it ain't a love issue. You said yes to God, you love him. You got to say yes. If you said yes to God, it's proof that you love him. But do you trust him? And he's telling you right here, contend for the faith. Contend means to fight. Fight for the faith. If you are in a relationship with someone, even in your relationship with God, stop focusing on how much you love that person. Because that's not going to sustain it. You got to focus on how much you trust that person. Do you trust that person enough? Hold on. Do you trust God enough, right? Do you trust God enough to actually take your eyes, take your hands, right? And cover your eyes, right? You take your hands and you cover your eyes. And what you begin to do is you begin to walk. And you don't see where you're going. You're just trusting his voice to say, Enrique, go straight. Stop right there. Wait for 5 minutes. Don't look at it. Okay, now move right. Okay, keep going. Can you trust him to the point where his voice supersedes what you see? Somebody say wisdom. I like that, Holy Spirit. Can you trust your mate enough where what they say supersedes what you see? Because I'm telling you that paranoia will have you put your mate in a place that he or she isn't in. It'll have you say, I know you cheating on me. And the dude in the chapel praying for you. I know you do wrong. And she in the laundromat washing your dirty clothes. I know God ain't listening. And God is sending angels. And you so blinded by fear that you thinking that God going to send the angel this way and God send the angel that way. But because of fear and paranoia, you missed it. Why? Because you don't trust it. See, when you really trust someone, right? When you really trust God, you let him do the directing. All you do is the following. Father, even though I don't understand it, even though this don't feel good, even though I don't really know what's going on, I tell you what, I trust you. I mean, you trust your GPS? You put that thing on your GPS. You go to Google and you put that thing in there. Or you put your ways in there. And I tell you what, I hear you, Holy Spirit, because it happened to me. Sometimes I put my stuff on my GPS, right? And sometimes I say, man, I ain't going that way. I'm used to going this way. I ignore what Waze says. Waze says, get off. I'm like, why would I get off? I'm going straight. Waze says, get off. I'm not getting off. Waze sees what I don't see. Waze has the heads up of what's happening 2 miles away. And when I don't get off, I end up in 1 hour of traffic. If I would have listened to Waze and trusted Waze versus what I feel, I would have gotten off the exit. Don't we do that with God? I hear you, but this is what I want to do. I hear you, but this is how I feel. And God is saying, you're nearsighted. You can't see what's ahead. I'm telling you to stop right now. I'm telling you not to go there. I'm telling you don't do this and don't do that. And you're ignoring what I'm telling you. Why? Because you love him, but you don't trust him. Lord, have mercy. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wonderful? Let me show you how important this thing, this trusting is. Let's go to the next slide. Let's go to Luke chapter 18, verse 8. Look at this. Look how powerful this is. We there? Look what it says. I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth? Lord, have mercy. Hold up. We know that the Son of Man is coming back. We know he's coming. And if you don't know he's coming, then we got to talk about this a little later on. Because Jesus is coming whether you're ready or not. And here's the good thing about the Word of God. You don't have to guess what he's coming for. He's coming looking for one thing, for faith. He ain't coming looking for love. Isn't that amazing?
He's not looking for peace. And he's the Prince of Peace. Isn't that amazing? He's saying that when I come back, when I return, I'm looking for people who are in faith. In other words, people who believe in God. How do you know you believe God? Okay, and what does that look like? Okay, what does faith look like? Trust and believe. What? Give me an illustration. What does faith look like? Faith, listen, this is what faith looks like. Doing what God says no matter what. No matter how it looks or how I feel, it's doing what God says. God, I don't understand, but I'm doing it anyway. That's faith. So Jesus is saying, when he come back, there's a good chance that people will not be in relationship with God because people will be doing their own thing versus what he says to do. My God, that's a rebellious society. That's scary. You know why that's scary? Because there's never a time that God is not speaking and directing which way you should go. And the reason why that's scary is because you are ignoring the voice of correction, you're ignoring the voice of protection, and you're listening to the voice of destruction. And the reason why that's scary is because that looks like a godless society. And we're seeing that now. I want to say this to you. Write this down. Out there in social media, put this for me in the comment section. God's greatest desire is to be believed. Say that. Say, God's greatest desire is to be believed. Say this. God's greatest disappointment is to be doubted. I'm going to let that sit for 1 minute. God's greatest desire is to be believed. God's greatest disappointment is to be doubted. If you want to hurt God and damage God, tell him you don't trust him and see what happens. It'll devastate him. You know why? He put everything on the line for you to trust him. He put everything on the line for you to trust him, and yet you don't trust him. You know what that means? That means that what we tell God, oh boy, somebody may cry on this, but it's okay. When you don't trust God, what you're telling him is that what he did on the cross wasn't sufficient. There's something else he should do. You didn't do enough. Because what I'm saying is, he can't give you more than what he gave you. He bet it all. How can you not, Holy Spirit, I love you. How can you not love someone who put himself on the line? Oh boy. Jesus is God in the flesh. Say amen to that. Amen, amen to that. Say amen. So Jesus is God in the flesh. And what God did was, he took his word and he put his word, wrapped his word into him, and he put that on the cross. All right. You know, like being from New York, right, back in the day, when somebody was real or supposed to be real, they'll say, word bond. My word is my bond. Word bond. What his word is his bond. And now, see, somebody may give you a word that's a bomb with no action or proof to it. We got proof in the blood. We got proof on the cross. He just didn't say it. He said it with demonstration. You see what I'm saying? So, in other words, he put his money where his mouth is. You got a lot of people who will give you a word that's a bond, and that word ain't worth a penny. But he didn't put money on the line. He put the blood on it. Good God Almighty. And the blood paid the price for everything once and for all. That's why Jesus said, it is finished. He ain't going to do it again. And we're looking for something to be done again. Why? He finished it. Do you run a race after you finished it? He ran the race, put himself on the cross, rose himself up. What else you want from the man? How can you not trust him? And if you don't want to trust him, he got holes to prove to you, I did it. You don't believe me? Look at the hole. Look at the hole. Thomas, you don't believe me? Take your hands and put it in my side, just in case you don't believe that I did the work. My goodness. Isn't that wonderful? We are in relationship with someone who backs up what he said. That's why he calls himself the Word. And that's why it says that his word would not return unto him void. It would accomplish what he desired and achieve the purpose for which he sent it. Praise God. We're not in relationship with a liar. We are in relationship. Let's go to the next slide. I'm almost done. Y'all enjoying this though? He put his word on the line. Isn't that wonderful? That we got a book, right? We can say, well, did God really say that? Well, it's in the word. Well, yeah, he said it. You don't have to remix it. Why don't you trust him? And then to make it even more better, he wrote the word pertaining to his promises concerning Jesus in red. It stands out than any other wording in the Bible. That means the blood signed it. I mean, what else you want? More blood? I mean, like, it's as if one drop of blood of Jesus isn't enough to cover everything. What, y'all want a pint? A gallon? We don't need it. He dropped the blood. How would your relationship change if you have that absolute mindset knowing this is real? That, you know what would happen? If you had the absolute mindset that this is real, you can look at something that's contrary to what you're seeing and look at that and say, you a liar. I'm holding on to this Bible. I'm standing on this word. That's a lie. Even though I see it, that's deception. That's the matrix. Because let God be true. Come on now. I said let God be true. Come on now. I said, let God be true. If anything contrary to that shows up, that's a lie straight from hell. We know Satan is a liar. You know how we know he a liar? You remember when Moses went to Pharaoh's house? And Moses walked in there, you know, walking. You know, like how Moses is walking. And he had his cane and he put his cane down. And then that thing turned to a serpent. Remember that? And then Pharaoh's boys came and said, hold up, dude. That ain't nothing. You got a snake? They put their staff down and it turned to a snake. But what happened? Moses' snake looked at those snakes and said, hold up, you ain't real. And Moses' snake just slithered over there and ate their snake. And it disappeared. It turned back to a staff and Moses held the real deal. The word of God. We got to get to a point where when we see something that don't line up with this, in the name of Jesus, you are an imposter. You're a liar. This is a magic trick. And magic ain't real. Whew. That's great. Y'all feel the anointing? Look what it says here. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18 to 22. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18 to 22. But as surely as God is faithful, our message to you is yes and no. For the Son of God, Jesus Christ, who was preached among you by us, by me, Silas, and Timothy, was not yes and no, but in him has always been what? In him has always been what? Yes. Man, let me tell you something. You looking for your yes. And I'm going to tell you, you don't have to look for it. You already got it. Look what it says. It says, in him has always been yes. You got your yes. I'm waiting to hear from God. Why? You got your yes. Move. Stop not trusting. I love you, Lord. That's the problem. You loving too much. Get the trust going. I love you, God. You love it, but you ain't moving with your untrusting self. God know you love him, but where your trust is? Or where is your trust? Where your trust is? Somebody need to have a search party. Have you found my trust? Trust, where is you? Where is you? Where is you, trust? And when you find it, hold on to that thing. Let it go nowhere. Praise God. Look at that. Look, I'm going to still go. Verse 20. For no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Christ. Listen to what it says. For no matter how many promises God has made. Say this with me. Say, God's promises are yes in Christ. Say this. Say, I got my yes. That means when you leave here, you're going to move in your yes posture. You ain't going to move like, I don't know. I know. Break that concrete. Walk like one of them soldiers that's in England. Why? You confident. You got your yes. I'm waiting for my yes. He says all his promises are yes in who? Come on now. Praise God, verse 21. And through verse 20, and so through him the amen is spoken by us to the glory of God. Verse 21. Now, it is God who makes both us and you stand firm in Christ. He anointed us. Verse 22. Watch this. Set his seal of ownership on us and put his spirit in our hearts. Come on now. As a deposit. Don't let me get out of here, boy. He put his spirit in our heart as a deposit. He made a deposit. What you looking for? Come on now. Guaranteeing what is to come. Jesus Christ, have mercy. He made a deposit. And his deposit guarantees your outcome. Oh boy. Loose me, Holy Spirit. I'm about to take off. Okay. God knows, all-knowing God, infinite God, knows that humans have trust issues. And so for that reason, he made a deposit that guarantees the outcome. If the deposit guarantees the outcome, he took the trust factor out of the equation. You got what I'm saying? He took the trust issue out of the equation because he made a bona fide deposit that guarantees his yes. It's a guarantee. Say, I got the guarantee. So if you got the guarantee, then the trust issue leaves today. Why? Because he made a deposit. He did not make a withdrawal. He put his money where his mouth is. He's not telling you just to trust him. He made a deposit so that you can trust him. Oh, come on, man. He's not just saying, you follow what I'm saying? Okay. It ain't like me saying, yo, man, yo, believe me. But if I show you the scar, then you got to believe it because I went through the pain to get you to believe and trust it. I trust her with my life. We got years put in it. Y'all just don't see the scars on both sides. And with this level of trust, I won't cash this in for nothing. Why? Because we got equity in this thing. Lord, have mercy. You got equity. Let me close this thing out. Because I can go. But I'm going to close this thing out. In Numbers 23, 19, and 20. Give me like 10 more minutes. Can I get like 10 more minutes to close this thing up? Is this good though? Are y'all getting this thing? Is it coming in and working on you? Praise God. Let's go. Numbers 23, 19. This is what we have to understand. And that's where you fall. Look, this is the bedrock of the Bible, Jacob. Jacob, Gerald, this is the bedrock of the Bible right here. Look what it says. God is not a man. Look what it says here. It says that God, he letting you know, I'm not like you. He telling you off right now. Human, with your finite thinking, with your limitations, I'm not like you. Look what he said. God is not a man that he should lie. Good Lord have mercy. Nor a son of man that he should repent. Has he said and will not do? Or has he spoken and will he not make it good? Now watch this. Watch this. Verse 20. Behold, I have received a command to bless. He has blessed and cannot reverse it. Hold up 1 second. Hold up. Don't miss that. I got to park my car right here for a minute. Look what it says. Verse 20. Behold, I have received a command to bless. DJ, pay attention. Listen now. He has blessed and I cannot reverse it. This is God, all powerful, infinite God, the creator of heaven and earth and all the universe. And he's saying that he blessed you and not that he will not reverse it. He's saying he cannot reverse it. He cannot undo what he already has done. Why can't you trust him with your everything? He can't change. He says it's not that he will not do it. He says he cannot do it. That's a big difference. To say he will not do it means that there's a choice. I hear you, Holy Spirit. But to say you cannot do it, it means he removed the option to flip the script on you. Ain't that something? When God removed the option to flip the script, how bona fide would your relationship be with God? How amazing would your relationship be with your husband, your wife, your mate, your boyfriend, girlfriend, fiance, whatever, if you remove the option of flipping the script? What would change between you and the Lord if you remove the option of flipping on him whenever you get emotional? How far would things go between you and him if you took the same stance that he took on you and not be reverse-minded? What level of deposits are we missing out on? Because we are always in reverse mode when things don't happen the way we hope and pray and wish. And we are trying to manipulate God to do it our way at this particular time, in this particular way, in this direction. But what would happen if we just said, we're not going in reverse, we're going forward. Bump in the road, I'm going forward. Things ain't right, I'm going forward. I don't know reverse when it comes to you. Why? Because you don't know reverse when it comes to me. I'm going to give you drive because you give me drive. I'm not going to give you reverse. I'm going to be going forward because you will not flip the script on me. What would happen if we don't flip the script on God? Oh, my God. Could you imagine what things would be like? Where would the church be, the people in the church, if we weren't in retreat mode every time something happened? Oh, my God. Oh, I'm in retreat mode. I'm not. Something went wrong. What would happen if we had the mentality of I'm going forward no matter what? Why? Because I can trust you. I'm going forward no matter what. Why? I believe in you. I'm going forward no matter what. What? Because you made a deposit in me and you said you won't take it back. I'm going forward. I'm almost there. In Titus chapter 1, verse 2, it says, in hope of eternal life, which God, that cannot lie, promised before the world began. That cannot lie. Say, God cannot lie. All right, I'm bringing this home right now. Gerald, I want you to skip some slides and tell me, give me a thumbs up when you are at 1 Samuel. Say, God cannot lie. Isn't that wonderful? Not that he will not, thank you, but he cannot. Isn't that wonderful? He removed the option to even lie. Why? It ain't in him. It's not in him. It's not in him. You signed a contract for that car and you believe the contract that you signed. You signed a contract for that home, and you believed the builder, and you didn't see near brick or wood in the place laid out, and you trust the house. And he laid the blood on the line, and you questioning that? How can you question the blood and yet trust the house that you in? Gerald just drove a car the other day, and the wheels messed up, and God preserved his life. Look what I'm saying. It wasn't the manufacturer that kept that man alive. It was the blood of Jesus. That they told him he could have died in that car. And the wheels stayed on the car somehow, some way. And I know it wasn't the manufacturer that kept the wheel on. He wasn't there when Jerry was doing 85, 90, 100 on the highway. When Jerry was doing 99 on the highway, the manufacturer of the car wasn't there. Who kept the tires on that car while Jerry was doing 105? Jesus. Don't trust the product. Trust the manufacturer. All right, so let me give y'all a takeaway. Praise God. Was this good? All right, here's the takeaway. Here's the takeaway. Let's go to 1 Samuel chapter 34 to 37. You ready? Okay, 34 to 37. And look what it says. Is that? No, I'm sorry. Chapter 17. That's my fault. 1 Samuel chapter 17. I made a mistake. Chapter 17, verse 34 to 37. I apologize. That's on me. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 34 to 37. Look what it says. But David said to Saul, pay attention, okay, guys? But David said to Saul, so David said something, right? He says, your servant used to keep his father's sheep. And when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb out of the flock, I went out after it, and I struck it, and delivered the lamb from its mouth. And when it arose against me, I caught it by its beard and struck it, and I killed it. Verse 36, your servant has killed both lion and bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, seeing he has defied the armies of the living God. Verse 37. Moreover, David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go, and the Lord be with you. I'm done. Y'all ready? I'm going to bring it in right now. This is how we have to take steps to build up our trust in God. You ready? All right. You got to go down memory lane. All right. When you go down memory lane, you remember the things that you experienced in the past that you know God delivered you from. All right. When you remember, that car accident should have killed me. I should have been in jail for 50 years. I should have died based on this. When I was homeless, he kept me straight. Now I'm in the home. And when you remember your past victories, come on. When you remember what God delivered you from, when you remember where he took you from. See, many of us in the church got amnesia. We forgot where we came from. We forgot the things we've been through. We forgot all the hell that God delivered us from. So now we're putting demands on something instead of saying, I remember. I remember. So wait a minute. I killed a lion and a bear. Hold up. The lion and the bear took the sheep, and I went and I got the sheep. So that's one thing that happened. So I recovered what was lost. Say with me. Say wisdom. God would allow you to recover what the enemy stole from you. So the lion and the bear took the sheep, and God allowed David to recover what was lost. That's the first step. But now Satan will come after you when you recover what was lost. So when the lion and the bear came after David, then David said, then when they came after me with my hands, I killed the lion and the bear. Say wisdom. See, what I'm saying is, the very thing that's trying to kill you, God would give you the empowerment to kill it. You got it? Number one, here is your takeaway. Number one, you're going to recover everything that's been lost. When you trust God, you're going to recover everything that has been lost. Number two, you're going to kill everything that try to kill you. All you got to do is go down memory lane. That's all you got to do. Matter of fact, what we should do is, for the next 3 days, there go my challenge again. There go 3-day challenge. Sit down somewhere and get a pen and a piece of paper, even your phone, and go back down memory lane and start to jot down, man, this was God right here. Mm-hmm. Boom, that was God, man. Wow, that was God. And when you finish seeing a list of a thousand things, then that might increase your trust just a little bit. That may give you just a little more trust in him and a little more hope. And then that when you have more trust in him and more faith in him, then it changes how you pray. You don't pray with I wish you could or woulda. And you don't become a pretzel in the process of it all. Cross eyes and cross hands and cross fingers, hoping that your prayer worked because you all crossed up. You don't need to be crossed up. He went on the cross for that. All you got to do is remember like David did. And if you remember where he delivered you from, where you came from, then you got the victory. Put your hand on your head. Say, Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for my memory. Moving forward, I would use this memory to remind me of the victory. Moving forward, I trust you with all of my heart. I lean not on my own understanding. In everything I do, I promise you to acknowledge you, and you will make my path straight, and you will direct my path. Thank you, Jesus. I have the mind of Christ. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Praise God. Boy, that was richer than rich. Wasn't that awesome? Praise God. It's time to sow into this blessed ministry. Come on now. It's time to sow into this blessed ministry called Fit for the Kingdom. Global ministry. Boom. You better remember. It says, hold up. In scripture it says, Remember the Lord your God, for it is he who give you the power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which he swear to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, as it is this day. So remember God right now as you sow this seed. Praise God. Hallelujah. He gave you the power to obtain wealth. Remember, remember, remember. Always use your memory. It's a gift. Use it. The word, text the word give to 804-348-8300. Text the word give to 804-348-8300. Father, in the name of Jesus, I prophesy of awesome ministry building for this church. I decree a building just amazing with all kind of rooms, with clothes and food and, I mean, computer rooms and tutoring. I speak, Father God, a building that, Father God, will do your work in the earth for this church coming in the very near future. I remember when I did not have and now I do. I decree it in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Watch and see. Watch and see what happened. In Jesus' name. Did I say text the word give to 804-348? I did that. 804-348-8300. Praise God. All right. I feel good. I may fly after service. I feel like I feel the anointing. Yes, I feel the anointing. All right, let's pray over this offering. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We remember that it is you, Father, who gives us the ability to get wealth. And you do it for one reason, Father, to establish your covenant, which you swear to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, as it is this day. So, Father, as we now remind you of this covenant, we thank you that you're going to take this seed sowed and multiply it, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. Now shall men give back to us in Jesus' name. And Father, we remind you that as we give this seed to you, you're going to do for us as you did to that young lad, giving us back 12 baskets for our giving. In other words, Father, we are expecting an expedited return with interest. We thank you, Father, that you're seeing the sacrifice. You're seeing the obedience. And we thank you for an expedited return on this sowing with interest. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Come on, lovely wife. It's your birthday. It's your birthday. Go, Trina. It's your birthday. It's your birthday. Hey. Okay.
Yes, Lord, it's my birthday. You know what I got a desire for?
Talk
my birthday?
To me.
That anybody that's watching right now will receive Christ as their Lord and Savior.
Hallelujah.
Boy, that would be the best birthday present.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Man, absolutely.
Uh-huh.
All about souls.
Yes, it's about souls. So if you're watching and this message, it bears witness with you, your spirit, and you want to know the guy that we're talking about, his name is Jesus, who we are in relationship with. We have a personal relationship with Jesus. And if that is on your heart right now, all you have to do is a simple prayer. And all you have to say is, Jesus.
Jesus.
I'm asking you. To forgive me of all my sins.
To forgive me of all my sins.
I am now receiving you as Lord over my life.
As Lord over my life.
So as I ask with my mouth. And receive you in my heart.
And believe that you died on the cross.
And was raised from the dead. For my sins. Thank you, Lord. For saving me. I am now your child. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Because the angels in heaven are rejoicing on behalf of you. I'm so happy for you. Thank you for my birthday present if this is your first time. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Something going on here. So some new people here. So
yeah.
Yeah. My mom came to church.
Yes, today. Yes. Yeah. What a blessing. Hallelujah.
Yes. And Pia. We got Pia. P did it.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Praise God.
It feels so good to be loved. Right?
Yeah, yeah, it feels good to be loved. And hey guys, look. It is really a privilege that you guys trust and honor us. We want to say to you guys out there as well, thank you so much for expanding our family. We have so many brothers and sisters, people who trust, believe, and love us. And let me tell you guys, we trust, believe, and love you just the same. And we're going to do all we can to just make sure that you guys get it. I hope that one thing y'all feel from us is that authentic love. I mean, we have this authentic love for every one of you guys. And if there's anything we can do to assist you along the way, please reach out to us. We are here for you. With that being said, it is very important to us that we take what we're getting seriously and start to not just come here and say it's a great message and good teaching and good worship. At some point, we got to put practice to what we're getting. This is about growth. This ministry here, we don't do babies here. We don't do babies here. We're about growing people up. So let's honor the Lord this week by showing him how much we trust him. When the tide gets flat, laugh at it. Lord, I trust you. When they come knocking at your door for whatever issue, man, I trust you. When the issue shows up, in the name of Jesus, I trust you. He know you love him, but your love is limited because your relationship with God would only grow to the level of the trust that you have for him. Thank you guys for celebrating with us today. Celebrate your birthday. Nene, we love you. Happy birthday to you as well. And we're going to see you guys on Tuesday for an awesome Bible study. And y'all get ready for this building. It's coming in Jesus' name. Amen.
May the Lord bless you.
And keep you.
May he keep you. And may he make his face shine upon you. And give you his perfect, perfect peace.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. We love y'all. Thank you.